Hey, good morning, everyone. Let's all stand together. Let's just lift our voice to the Lord. Sing His praise this morning. Come to the light, come to the living water, never runs dry. You can trust the Father, He is good, and He satisfies. Come to the light, leave the empty shadow, trade the night. You can trust the Father, He is good, and He satisfies. Send His Son, Jesus. And we are made alive in You. Holy Spirit, You are making all things new. All of heaven shouts for joy, singing praises to the only King of life, Jesus Christ. Sing, come to the Lord, come to the Lord. Come lay down your burden, find your rest. You can trust the Father, He is good, and He satisfies. Come to the bread, all of you who hunger, never runs out. You can trust the Father, He is good, and He satisfies. Send His Son, Jesus, and we are made alive in You. Holy Spirit, You are making all things new. In all of heaven shouts for joy, singing praises to the only King of life. And we are made alive in You. Holy Spirit, You are making all things new. In all of heaven shouts for joy, singing praises to the only King of life. Come to the life, come to the living water, never runs dry. Let's all sing it together. And we are made alive in You. Holy Spirit, You are making all things new. And all of heaven shouts for joy, singing praises to the only King of life. And we are made alive in You. Holy Spirit, You are making all things new. And all of heaven shouts for joy, singing praises to the only King of life, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ.
Praise God. Amen. Well, hey, it's wonderful to be with you all this morning. It's great to be able to lift up our Savior, to lift up the Lord, to praise His name. There's a story in John chapter 1 where some men come to John the Baptist, who has been baptizing people, and, you know, ask him who he is, you know, what his deal is, what he's all about. And he says, hey, I'm here to prepare the way for another, for the Messiah. And then it says the next day, Jesus was coming towards him, and he declared out loud for everyone to hear. He says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. See, Jesus is that sacrificial lamb. He shed His blood. He bore our sin upon Himself so that we could be in right relationship with Him, so that we could be cleansed, so we could be made righteous in the eyes of God. And then in Revelation chapter 5, the Apostle John has this vision of the throne room of God. And it says that he was there, and the elders who were there in that throne room said to John, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, who has conquered, describing Jesus. So Jesus is described as both the Lamb who was slain for our sin, and also the Lion who has conquered. And so we're going to sing a song now that just celebrates that fact about our Savior. So let's just take this moment to worship Him for that, to declare that out loud, and to celebrate that this morning.
The Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Let's sing that out together. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring in power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before Him. Our God is a lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him.
God. Amen.
I've heard Prince of Wales. Think you're light, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night as you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen many searching for the sound of your great name. Oh, the enemy, he has to leave at the sound of your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us, the Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the
this morning, we exalt, we lift high, we loudly declare your great name, that name that is above every other name, that name to which every knee will bow and every tongue confess, the name of Jesus. Lord, to you we bring all honor, all glory, all praise. Lord, you deserve every bit of praise and honor that we could possibly bring. So Lord, we just lift our voices. We say aloud that we love you. We adore you, God. We worship you today. We're so thankful that we can be called your children. We're so thankful that we have been made righteous in the eyes of God through you. We are so thankful, Lord, that we can be one with you, not disconnected, not separated, but together. We're so thankful for that, Lord. We thank you this morning. And we take a few minutes right now to bring our tithes and our offerings to you. Lord, we know that everything that we have is a gift from you, that you've blessed us with, that you've provided to us. And so, Lord, just take some of that and return it to you. We do that with grateful hearts, with obedient hearts. And Lord, we just desire and we ask and we pray that the gifts that we bring, they would be used to spread your name throughout our community, so that many would come to know you and hear of you. So, Lord, we ask and pray that you bless it now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You guys can take a seat. Our ushers are going to come in just a moment. If you're a guest visiting with us today, don't feel as if you have to give. This is a time for our church family. But thank you for your giving. Let's continue to sing and worship.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, oh, come to the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar.
Stand with us and sing.
sing.
Oh, what a Savior. Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before Him. For He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen.
To the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open.
Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Father, we do, in coming to you this morning, remember that the cost of making a way for us to be able to come to you as our Father was immense, in that it was the blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, that you would put that kind of value upon us, that you would declare us as that important to yourself. The shedding of your own blood. We want to say to you this morning that we invite your fathering hand and work in our lives. If fathers are to protect and defend and teach and instruct, then we pray that you would defend and protect and teach and instruct us. If fathers are to define and guide and lead, then, Lord, we invite you to define us and lead us. Lord, we look to you. Would you, Father, grab a hold of our lives more and more to that perfect day? Thank you, God. We love you this morning and ask that your blessing would be upon, Lord, our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. Good morning, church. Hey, before you're seated, why don't you say hi to each other before we get into the Bible.
Company will never leave me long. And you, with your great company, will never leave me long. Sail away, you bright young man. Done. Grace will see you through. Sail away, you sweet, kind gal. The sea was made for you. Leave behind your old ways. Truth shall anchor you. So I will sail into the sea to places.
Welcome. Good morning. So glad you're here. I'm Pastor Jeff, one of the assistant pastors here. Thanks so much for being here. Every week we come as pastors, and we just look so forward to this time when the sheep gather, and thanks so much for being here. And if you're here for the first time, a special welcome to you as our guest. Hope that you'll take a moment, if you can, afterward, out the double doors, over to the right. You'll see a big desk there, our welcome center. We've got a gift bag we'd like to give you and make acquaintance with you. Thank you again for being here and taking the time to come. One way that you can find out more of what's happening around our church is subscribing to our weekly email, the Calvary Connection. If you go to our main page, calvary.com, you can sign up and find out more of what's happening around here, such as Easter will be here 3 weeks from today. And as you know, Good Friday and then Easter Sunday are grand traditions in the Christian church to celebrate the passion, the suffering, the death of Jesus, and then his resurrection. Now, the Good Friday services at 6 and 7:30 are unlike any other service we do the whole year. And our pastor has a way of taking us through the passion of Christ in a narrative fashion. It's a wonderful time. We encourage you to come. The restaurant will be open. And then you have an opportunity on Easter Sunday to attend one of our four services, 7, 9, 11, and 1. The 7 o'clock and the 1 o'clock are outdoor services out in our little amphitheater. And so the sunrise service, of course, at 7 o'clock will be a very special time as well. So bring a blanket, bring a child, bring a friend. And it is one of the times that we have, you know, maybe twice as many adults here on property as we usually do. And so it's a time when people are open to coming, and we encourage you to intelligently think, who might I bring, what neighbor, what friend. The restaurant will be open all through Easter, special buffet, roast beef, and so on. And so you can think about yourself having enough time with your family or the people you might bring. So we need many, many volunteers because it's a big, big task to put on that day. So if you go to calvary.com, you'll see a link at the bottom which tells about how to serve, 7 different areas to serve. Love to have your help. Next week, we have a wonderful thing which we call water baptism. The New Testament is very clear that an adult believer who makes a decision for Christ should follow Christ in water baptism. And I want to read to you what the Apostle Paul said in Romans 6, verse 4, about this wonderful thing called water baptism. It says this: we were buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead, so we too might walk in newness of life. And that's Christianity. It's a new life. The blackboard is erased. You get to start over, and it equates our newness of life with the resurrection power of Christ. And so as we leave next Sunday after this 11 o'clock service, right out there in the patio, there will be a baptistry, and we encourage you to stay and to watch believers identify with Jesus in his death, burial, and resurrection, making it their own. And if you have not been baptized in water, again, calvary.com. And if you scroll down, you'll see two little links. One says, get baptized. It's like a command. So get baptized. But the second is more information, and that's a video that will teach you all about water baptism based on Romans 6 and give you some of the specifics about that. So hope that you can be with us next Sunday. That's going to be a time of great rejoicing. That's it in the way of announcements. We are going to be studying Ruth chapter 2 in our ongoing series. If you're here without a Bible, please lift your hand, and our ushers will bring you one so you can follow along, Ruth chapter 2.
Thanks, Jeff. Good morning, everyone. Great to see you guys. Let's turn to Ruth chapter 2, like Jeff just mentioned, and we're just going verse by verse through the book of Ruth, when we started it last week, and look forward to jumping into chapter 2 with you this week. I hope the Lord's just blessing your life and watching over you, defending you, protecting you, leading you. We come in here with all of our questions and our worries and our anxieties, don't we? You know, just different things we need the Lord to help us with. Bran, if we could get another Bible over here, brother. And You know, we need the Lord's grace and help and strength, don't we? And so I just pray that the Lord is watching over you, helping you, defending you, and giving you strength for today and this week and what's in front of us. Yeah, I wanted to mention to you, you know, I just so agree with Pastor Jeff about the baptism. You know, if you've yet to be water baptized, I really encourage you to do so. I know that we've kind of started a tradition over the last few years where on Easter Sunday, we've actually had water baptisms during the services. But, you know, maybe we'll do that again at some point. But it's just kind of in my heart, I don't want people to wait for that day. The moment you get saved, I want us to have an opportunity that's right there on the horizon for you to be able to be water baptized. So we want to do them a little bit more regularly. And I was also just thinking about people who maybe are a little more shy, you know, and with the lights, because we would do them during Easter service, you know, so it's like the lights and the music and the video camera, like piping it into Sanctuary 2 and online and stuff like that. Might be a little much, you know. I mean, I'm all for a public declaration of your faith, but it doesn't necessarily mean you have to live stream it to the internet, you know. So to be able to just share your church family with your church family when you give your life to the Lord and you want to start walking with Him, so look forward to being able to be a part of your baptism next week if that describes you. Okay, so Ruth chapter 2. So last week we saw kind of the beginnings of the flow of the book of Ruth. We know that Ruth is going to marry this man named Boaz, and we're going to see him introduced today in our text. But last week we saw the backdrop of the whole story, and if you weren't here last week and you missed it, I'd encourage you to go back, podcast it, or get it at calvary.com or YouTube or whatever, and hear the story of the darkness that this book began with. This book is very similar, some of you probably noticed last week, to the book of Job, although it's a lot smaller and much less poetic, in that it begins with catastrophe and, you know, just a horrible situation, and it ends with God's redemption and God's restoration. It begins with this woman, Naomi, with her husband Elimelech, leaving God's territory and land and going to the Moabite territory, which was bad, and her husband Elimelech dying, or her two sons marrying Moabite women, and then they also died, and then Naomi is left with Orpah and Ruth, and then Ruth returns with Naomi back to Bethlehem. Orpah stays back in Moabite territory, and you remember last week, Naomi came back, and she told everyone in Bethlehem, I went away empty, or I went away full, and I've come back empty. And, that was her perspective on herself, and the point that we were making last week, or I don't know why I'm saying the point we were making, I was making the point, was that Ruth, or Naomi, she actually left quite empty, but she came back full with Ruth in her life. And so today, we're going to take a look now and shift our attention to Ruth and God's work in her life. So let's pray and ask God to help us as we study the scripture today. Father, we just come to you, and as we look at this second chapter of the book of Ruth, we want to grow from it. We want to be changed and impacted by it. So, Lord, would you help us? And, Lord, as we see the different elements in Ruth's life that positioned her for just a radical outpouring of your grace, and as we observe, Lord, this beautiful outpouring of your grace upon her life, we pray, Lord, that we'd be blown away by your grace towards us, and Lord, that we'd have the same similar priorities and focus of life that Ruth had, Lord. And so we ask and pray that you would strengthen us and help us, Lord, in your word today as we study it. And we thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, we pray together. Amen. Amen. In the book of 2 Chronicles, there's a king in Judah whose name was Asa. Asa was a descendant of King David, and Asa was a good king. Sometimes they had good kings, sometimes they had bad kings, and Asa was a good king. And when he started out, he did some wonderful things for the people in Judah. One thing that he did is he drove out the high places. These were places that they would sometimes, some of them, go to sacrifice to idols. And so he destroyed the high places, destroyed idolatry in Judah. Another thing that Asa did is that he built up various cities throughout Judah so that they were defensible in a military sense. And so he was protecting the people of Judah. But one of the earliest mentions or one of the earliest great things about Asa came when the Ethiopians came against him with a million-man army. And when that was happening, and they were coming down, kind of breathing down the necks of the people of Judah, he, you know, realized that he did not have the army to be able to defeat them. And so what he did, it was this classic moment in his life, he cried out to God. And he basically said, God, we cannot lean on the strength of man right now. We have to lean upon the power, the strength of God. And God strengthened him, strengthened them, and gave them the victory. Again, a very Israelite Old Testament style story, but he was a man who trusted in the Lord. Well, the years tick by in Asa's life. And in his latter years, there came a moment where a new enemy arose against the people of Judah. It actually came from the north, northern Israel, and a king named Baasha. And Baasha was building up a city called Ramah with the intention of attacking Asa and the people in Judah. And so Asa, this time, did not cry out to God. He didn't pray. Instead, what he did is he found a bunch of money, and he went to the Syrians, and he paid the Syrians to, with their armies, come against his enemy and give them the victory. And it worked. The Syrians came, they defeated the people up there in the north, and they were able to destroy Ramah, that city that was coming against them. And it looked like everything worked until a prophet named Hanani came to Asa. And he announced to Asa, he said, look, you did the wrong thing. You should have, like you did in your early years of your life, you should have cried out to God. You should have pled with him. You should have gone to the Lord. And then he said this incredible thing to him. Listen to this from 2 Chronicles 16, verse 9. He said, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to give strong support to those whose heart is blameless toward him. And then he said, you have done foolishly in this, for from now on you will have wars. But Hanani announced something powerful to Asa. He said, first of all, you need to know that God is always looking. And what is God always looking for? What is the eye of the Lord going to and fro throughout the earth looking for? Well, he's looking for people whose heart is blameless toward him. And when he finds a person whose heart is blameless toward him, then what God does is he acts in a way to where he gives strong support, it says there, to that person. He gives strong support to the person whose heart is blameless toward him. Here in Ruth chapter 2, that is exactly what we are observing. We are going to observe a woman named Ruth whose heart is blameless toward God. And the eyes of the Lord were at this time, during the times when the judges ruled, the eye of the Lord was looking throughout the people of Israel, looking for people whose heart was loyal to him, blameless toward him. Now, most people during the time of the judges were doing that which was right in their own eyes, not in the eyes of the Lord. But God, when he found this woman, Ruth, he found a woman who was devoted to him, a woman who was godly, a woman who was seeking him. And so God began to give strong support to this woman, Ruth. So what I want you to see today is I want you to see the ways in which God showed strong support towards Ruth. And I'm going to point out three specific ways that God showed that support to this woman, Ruth. But I want you to see the three ways in which Ruth's heart was blameless towards God. And so we're going to see three things about God today and three things about Ruth, starting with three things about God. So let's read the background to this chapter in verse 1 through 3 together. You guys with me? You guys with me? Okay. Verse 1 through 3. Now Naomi, verse 1, had a relative of her husband's, a worthy man of the clan of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. And Ruth, the Moabite, said to Naomi, let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain after him in whose sight I shall find favor. And she said to her, Naomi said to Ruth, go, my daughter. So, verse 3, she set out and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the clan of Elimelech. Now, I've explained to you guys that there's going to be a lot in this book that is very Israelite and Old Testament in nature, and this is one of those portions of the story that bears a little bit of explaining. Because Ruth goes to Naomi, and she says to her, hey, let me go out and try to find a field to glean in. And when she says that, she's not saying to Ruth, I need a job, or to Naomi, I need a job. Let's go see if anybody will hire me. No, what she's doing is she's leaning upon the law of the Old Testament. And in the law, God had told the people of Israel that when they went out to harvest their crops, they were to actually leave the corners of the crops untouched. And the idea was that someone who was poor could then come into the crops after the harvest, and they could glean from the corners of the fields. He'd also told them that when they went to reap their crops, they were just to go through and make that one full pass, and not to go back a second time, so that anything that they left could be given to the poor. And then also God had told them that when they would bind their sheaves, they were to take one sheaf and just plop it in the middle of the field. And it was just supposed to be like a bonus sheaf for anybody who was poor who would come in afterwards and needed some food. So what Ruth is doing is she's asking Naomi, would you let me go try that? And the way she says it in verse 2 is that I might find favor from someone. And what seems to be hinted at there is that there's probably not a lot of people in Israel, a lot of farmers in Israel, who are actually doing this thing that God had told them to do. But Ruth is saying, but maybe I'll find somebody. Because, I mean, that'd be a tough thing for a farmer to actually do, right? To leave the corners. You'd be sitting there looking at that going, man, I worked for that. And I planted those crops. I got that ground ready. That's my money. That's my labor. That's my toil that's gone into that. It'd be tough to take a sheaf and just plop it out there in the middle of the field and to give that to someone who's poor. It'd be tough to make one pass. And so probably by this time, not a lot of godliness in Israel. Ruth is saying, look, maybe we'll find somebody who still is holding fast to the Old Testament way of doing things and is obedient to the living God. Now, you might have noticed that first little paragraph begins and ends with the same idea. It talks about a guy named Boaz who was related to Elimelech. At the beginning, verse 1, and at the end, verse 3, it talks about Boaz, the relative of Elimelech. And what this is hinting at to us, you know, we all read this and we know, oh, Boaz. He's the guy that's related to Naomi's deceased husband, Elimelech. And so that means that Boaz is qualified to marry Ruth and redeem this family. He's the one that can secure a great future for Naomi and also for Ruth. And so with that in our minds, look at the little phrase there in verse 3. We already read it together, but it's beautiful. It says, and she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz. The way that the author writes it, our narrator writes it, it's like he wants it to sound like it was just an accident. Like it was just total chance, you know, just so random, you know, kind of thing. Like she just went out and of all the fields, lo and behold, she just happened to go to the field of Boaz. And of course, for Ruth, she had no idea, but God had every idea. And the first thing that I want you to see about God's movement in Ruth's life is that God involved himself in the details. He involved himself in the intricacies of her life. And this is the reality of the Bible through and through, that when a person is submitted to God, when they're walking with God, when they're enjoying God, when they're experiencing God like Ruth was, when that is happening in a person's life, God has an opportunity to be involved in the minutiae of their lives. God can arrange their lives. We call this the providence of God. And God is providentially leading this woman to this specific field on this specific day because he has a plan for her life. There's a little story. I love it. From the life of the prophet Elisha. I talked to you about him last week. But Elisha, he ministered to this Shunammite woman. And one of the things that he did for her is he raised her son from the dead. But there came a time in her life where a famine was coming upon Israel, and so Elisha was instructed by God to tell her to leave Israel for a period of time, and so she did. She went into Philistine territory for 7 years. And when she came back, she's poor. Her land that she left had been taken over by others. And so she needed to get her land back in order to be able to survive. She loves God, but she needs this land. And so she decides to go to the king in Israel to ask for her land to be returned to her. At the very moment that she goes to the king, Elisha's servant, Gehazi, he's there with the king. And just lo and behold, on that specific day, he's telling stories to the king about Elisha. And one of the stories he says, you'll never believe it, but there was this time where Elisha went in and he raised from the dead this Shunammite woman's son. And the king is sitting there going, man, this is incredible. I don't know. Can I believe this story? And just as Elisha is telling the story, the Shunammite woman walks in after 7 years of being gone. She walks in and Gehazi, the servant, he says, and there she is. And the king looks and says, did this really happen? Did your son get raised back to life? And she says, it did. And then he says, what are you here for today? And she says, I want my land back. And he's like, it's yours. If that happened to you, it's yours. The providence of God. God arranging the affairs of life. There's a little story in the book of Esther where Mordecai was threatened by a man named Haman. I was actually writing out my notes the other night, and my daughter June came in, and she looked at the screen, and she saw Haman mentioned, and she's like, oh, Haman. You know, we don't like Haman in the Holdridge house. He's a bad dude. Because Haman came to this point where he wanted to kill Mordecai. He thought that he would be able to ask the king to kill Mordecai for him, so he built a gallows to, on the very next day, ask for Mordecai to be executed. Well, that night, the king went to sleep, but he couldn't sleep. And so he asked for some of his servants to come and read him the governmental records, because he thought, if anything can make me go to sleep, it'll be that, you know? And so they start reading to him. And they read to him on that very night of this account, years earlier, when Mordecai had uncovered an assassination plot against the king. And they read this story, and he goes, wait, hold on a second. What did Mordecai receive as a payment for uncovering that assassination plot? And they look in the records and they say, well, we can't find anything. So Haman comes in the next day thinking, I'm going to ask for Mordecai to be killed. And the king says, oh, Haman, I'm so glad to see you. He says, what should be done for the man I want to honor? And Haman's like, he must be talking about me. There's nobody else he could be talking about. And so he goes, well, you should get like a horse and have somebody important carry, you know, lead the horse and put the guy on the king's horse and have everybody bow down to him. And the king's like, that is such a good idea, Haman. You're just the guy to ask. Put Mordecai the Jew on the horse and you lead it, you know? And Haman's like, oh man. But the very day, this is the providence of God, the leadership of God. When a person like Ruth submits themselves to the Lord and his plan in their lives, God will work in the details of their lives. Do you believe this? Do you believe that as you are walking with the Lord, that as you're faithful to him, that his providence is involved in the details of your everyday life? Like in the New Testament, when Philip was commanded by God to go into the wilderness of Gaza, and he finds this Ethiopian there reading the Bible, and he's reading from Isaiah 53 about the lamb that was slain. It's all about Jesus. And he comes, and he's like, do you know what you're reading? And the guy says, no, how can I know unless I have an interpreter? And Philip's like, well, I think I could do that. This is God providentially leading a man's life. And so here we're seeing how God involved himself in the life of Ruth. Now it says in verse 4, and here's where we get into the actual story itself. It says, and behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem. And he said to the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered, the Lord bless you. This is designed to help us understand that Boaz was unique. He's a godly man. He's a good man. He comes out. you know, to his fields, and he tells all his workers, the Lord be with you. And then they answer to him, the Lord bless you. So it probably sounds just like the job you're going to go to tomorrow morning, right? You know, just everybody all about Jesus. No? Okay, so that's what was happening there for Boaz. And, you know, in this, he's a picture of an incredible leader. It says in Colossians chapter 4, verse 1, masters, treat your bondservants justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. You know, we have to allow, especially if we're responsible for people in the workplace, if there's people that we're caring for, if you're a leader in the kind of way that Boaz was a leader, we have to make sure that we allow our Christianity to impact the way that we work, the way that we treat people. And Boaz here, a man who loved the Lord, he had cultivated a special kind of environment out there in his fields. Then Boaz, verse 5, said to his young man who was in charge of the reapers, whose young woman is this? Now, I don't know exactly how this all went down. You know, the way that I read it, there was a little bit of attraction there coming from Boaz towards Ruth. I'm sure that he, you know, because he's a guy, he's trying to play it all cool, like all natural, you know, just like, yeah, so I'm just kind of trying to figure out who all these new workers are, like especially that one over there, you know, who that, you know, kind of thing. And so he asks, you know, who is this young woman? Well, the servant or the foreman in verse 6, who was in charge of the reapers, answered, she is the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves after the reapers. So she came, and she has continued from early morning until now, except for a short rest. Now, what this part of the story tells us is that word about Ruth had already spread throughout Bethlehem. Boaz could not have picked her out of a police lineup at this point because he didn't know what she looked like. But everybody had heard the story of what she'd done. The foreman alludes to that she had left Moab, that she had joined herself to Naomi. And the assumption is that Boaz would go, oh, okay, that's her. That's who this is. He'd heard about her character. He heard about what she'd done. Then Boaz, verse 8, said to Ruth, now listen, my daughter, do not go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my young women. Let your eyes be on the field that they are reaping and go after them. Have I not charged the young men not to touch you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink what the young men have drawn. Now this is really great of Boaz at this point. You know, he basically shows great favor to Ruth. He tells her, you know, don't go into another field. Just stay in my field. And here in my fields, you'll be well cared for. And then he tells her, you know, and just stay with the young women. You know, just hang out with the girls. You don't need, I know that there's these young men out here in the field, and they're all sweaty and ripped and, you know, all that. But, like, you don't need to go over there. Just hang out with the young women. They'll be good to you. And then anytime you're thirsty, you go to the vessels that my servants drink from. And whatever they've drawn, you know, you are allowed to drink. You know, all joking aside and putting the romantic part of this aside, I think it's important to see what God is doing here. God is looking at Ruth, and he is making a decision to take care of Ruth by sending Boaz into her life. And I think the second great thing that we see here about God, beyond him just working in the intricacies of her life, is that God is answering her prayers with a person. God is sending his emissary. God feels that he wants to take care of Ruth, so he sends a person. And so what we're seeing here is God sending his emissary into this woman's life. You know, the reality is that so often in our prayers, God's answer to our prayers will so often come in the form of a person. And so often we are supposed to be God's answer to other people's prayers. Obviously, Christ came and is the Savior of the world and the one who ministers to the needs of the world, but we are the body of Christ, and we are to be His emissaries here on earth. And so maybe a question that we would ask at this point is, who has the Lord called me to be a help to? And who has the Lord raised up to be a help to me? At the end of the day, it all comes down to the relationships that God has given to us. The people that will minister to us and the people that we will minister to. I so love the Apostle Paul, and you guys know that. You know, he's just an amazing man. And the last chapter that he wrote in the Bible is 2 Timothy chapter 4. It was the final book that he wrote, and he wrote it with full knowledge that he was about to die. He said, I'm about to be poured out as a drink offering. He was very sure that he was going to be martyred. And as he closed his final book, or his final letter, he said in 2 Timothy 4, verse 9, to Timothy, he said, do your best to come to me soon. For Demas, in love with the present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia. Titus to Dalmatia. Luke alone is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he's very useful to me for ministry. And Tychicus I have sent to Ephesus. The reason I read that entire paragraph is because I wanted to point out to you that Paul is talking about seven different men as his life is wrapping up, as his ministry is ending. And you've got this guy who has to ask someone else to bring parchments and to bring a cloak to him as he's there in prison. Paul was a man who died with hardly any material goods, but he was a wealthy man. And part of the reason that he was so wealthy is because of the people that were in his life. I want to die. When I die, I want to be able to ask someone to travel hundreds and hundreds of miles just to bring me a jacket. I want to have that kind of relationship with people that we've so fought together and so served one another and so cared for one another, that there's that kind of value in our relationship. And so here we see God saying, look, I want to care for Ruth, so I'm going to send Boaz. I'm going to send a man. Not only that, but obviously, just practically, it doesn't take much to just consider that another thing that God is doing, he's involving himself in the intricacies of her life, and he's sending his emissary. But lastly, this is very simple, he's providing for her. Right? I mean, that's what he's doing. He's providing for her. This poor girl, she goes out into the field, and she's there to glean, and God allows it. And God brings Boaz, and she's fed, she's taken care of, she's provided for. And I can't pass this little verse or little section without just simply reminding you that, you know, as Paul said to the Philippian church, my God will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. It's almost shocking in our westernized civilization that we even need that kind of reminding and even need that kind of exhortation. I'm sure there are many peoples throughout the world that would say, surely if there is a group of people who is not worried about money, it would be those people. It'd be the people there in the United States, no worry, but we do. We have that worry and that concern in our hearts, don't we? I'd remind you of what Jesus said to the multitudes as they gathered. He said to them, you know, consider the birds. Your Father feeds them, and consider the flowers of the field. They're adorned beautifully. And so your Father, who knows the hairs on your head, he will take care of you. Which of you, by worrying, can add a cubit to the length of your life, to your height? It'll do nothing. And so Jesus said, so seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. You just have to notice this little girl. She goes out into the field, this young woman. She's got nothing. And the Lord is taking care of her. The Lord is providing for her. The Lord is feeding her. The Lord is giving her everything that she needs. And so, do you believe this? Can you rest in this? That as you walk with God, God will provide for you. All right, so in verse 10, Let's read the rest of the story and kind of turn our attention to Ruth now. We're seeing the way God has been working, but it says in verse 10 that then she fell on her face, bowing to the ground, and said to him, "Why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me since I'm a foreigner?" She just blown away. She went out to the fields hoping she could just find somebody that was doing the whole Old Testament law thing, and now Boaz is just like, "Stay in my field, I'll take care of you, it's all good." And so she's just blown away by this favor, and she says, Why have I been given this kind of favor? And so Boaz, in verse 11, tells her why. Let's read it together. "But Boaz answered, 'All that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told me, and how you left your father and mother and your native land, and came to a people that you did not know before. The Lord repay you for what you have done, and a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge.'" She asked the question of Boaz, "Why? Why are you having this kind of favor towards me? Why are you blessing my life in this kind of way?" And Boaz doesn't say, "Oh, you know, no reason." He gives her two specific reasons. He says, number one, "I heard what you have done for Naomi. I heard that you left Moab and you adopted this old Israelite woman. So I heard about that. And then secondly, I heard that you have come under the shelter of the shadow of the wings of the God of Israel. So you have made a decision to love Naomi, and you made a decision to love God. And when I heard about that, it made me want to provide and to take care of you." Now this, to me, this statement from Boaz is the centerpiece of this entire movement, this entire story taking place out in the field. It's the entire centerpiece of Act 2. Remember last week I told you about the backdrop of this whole book. It's listed in chapter 1, verse 1, in the days when the judges ruled. And I explained to you that the days of the judges were dark days in the nation of Israel. Well, when you go back and you read the book of Judges, the whole book follows a very basic format. It's trouble and trial and sin, followed by slavery, followed by crying out to God, followed by a judge, a hero, a deliverer. And this cycle is repeated over and over and over again through the whole book of Judges until you get to the end. At the end of the book of Judges, there are these two crazy illustrations of the darkness that was happening in Israel at the time of the judges. The first story centers around this guy named Micah. And Micah stole some silver from his mom, and with that silver, he built an idol to worship. He took some more money, and he hired a Levite to come and be his personal household priest. And then it got even more bizarre because some Danites, some people from the tribe of Dan, were passing through, and they stopped by Micah's house, and they're like, "Oh, sweet idol and sweet priest. And look at that. You have your own little personal thing going on. Why don't you come with us?" And Micah said no. And so the Danites stole his idol and stole his little personal priest. That's the first really bizarre story. The second story is even more bizarre and is actually very grotesque. There was a Levite who had a concubine. That's a bad thing. He took her to a city in the tribe of Benjamin called Gibeah. And the people in Gibeah were so depraved at that time in Israel's history that they wanted to rape the man. But instead, the woman went out and they violated her to the point that she died. It's a horrible story. He then took her body, cut it up into 12 pieces, and sent it throughout the nation of Israel to say to Israel, "This is abhorrent that something like that has happened in here in God's house." And the people of Israel fought against Benjamin until they dealt with the problem, the depravity that was there in Gibeah. It's just a horrible thing. It's hard for me to even say it or retell the story out loud. But in both of those stories, what do you see? The idolatry, means that they had said, we will not be lovers of God, we will love idols. And treating human beings like they treated them in Gibeah said, we don't value people. We don't love people. We don't care for people. We'll instead violate, abase, kill human beings. And what you have here in Ruth is a third example. Because God at the end of Judges said, this is bad, Micah, this is bad, Gibeah, but look at Ruth. Ruth loves God, and Ruth loves her fellow man. Ruth loves the God of Israel, and Ruth lays down her life for Naomi. This is what Boaz sees, a shining light in the middle of an ugly and dark and broken world. You might remember the words of Jesus at this point when they asked him, what's the greatest commandment? He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And Ruth was living that out. She was flesh and blood, loving God and loving neighbor. And this, I think, was a major ingredient to unlocking the beautiful, crushing grace of God upon her life. And if we could remember this, that life boils down to this simple thing. Am I loving God? Am I loving mankind? Am I loving God? And am I loving the people that God has placed in front of me? They asked Jesus one day, teacher, who is my neighbor? And he told the story of the Good Samaritan. Well, your neighbor, that's the person that you've come across, the person that's hurting, the person that's broken. It's not hard to find broken and hurting people in the world that we're living in. So neighbors are all around for us to be able to love and to care for. And Ruth was living like that in a day when not many people did. Now, verse 13, let's see the next thing about Ruth. Not only did she love God and love her neighbor, but it says in verse 13 that she said, I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, for you have comforted me and spoken kindly to your servant, though I am not one of your servants. Now, she'd said this already at first. She said, why have I found favor in your eyes? And then he tells her, and notice what happens. She doesn't hear it and hear about, oh, you loved Naomi and you loved God. And then she doesn't hear that and then respond by saying, oh, well, I thought it was grace. I thought it was favor, but now I'm glad I know why you've given me all this favor. It's not favor at all. It's a wage because I'm such an incredible person. And good people like me, we deserve for good stuff to happen to us in our lives. No, that wasn't the attitude of Ruth at all. She responds and she says, no, it's still grace. It's still grace. That you would do this for me, it is still grace. And as the eyes of the Lord are looking throughout the world, I think he found in Ruth, number two, about this woman. He found a woman who felt that it was all of grace. You know how this works in our lives, right? You know, Lord, I've been doing good. You know, Lord, I've been going to church and I put a little in a basket, Lord, you know. I've been faithful. You know, Lord, I've been serving. You know, or Lord, I read my Bible, you know. I even read like every word of that genealogy, you know. I did the whole thing, you know. So Lord, you know, you owe me. No, that wasn't Ruth's heart at all. She says, it's still grace. Even though I'm wanting to walk with the Lord, love God, love man, it still is the grace of God. Like Paul said in Romans chapter 3, verse 27, he said, what becomes of our boasting? He said, it's excluded. By what kind of law? By the law of works? No, but by the law of faith. If we've been justified by faith, there is no room for us to boast about anything. It's all of grace. It's all of the Lord. You remember Jesus, he told the story of the tax collector and the Pharisee when they went to the house of God to pray. The Pharisee, he said, God, I'm so thankful. Actually, the way Jesus said it is that he prayed with himself. It was kind of like Jesus' way of saying, like, God wasn't really involved in this prayer. He just prayed out loud to himself, basically, and he said, I'm thankful that I'm not like other men. I'm not like extortioners and murderers and covetous. And God, if you need an example of what I'm glad that I'm not like, I'm glad I'm not like this tax collector over here. I tithe, I do all these things. The tax collector, though, beat on his chest and he said, God, have mercy upon me, a sinner. And Jesus said that only one of those men, the tax collector, went down to his house justified that day. They were conscious. He was conscious of the grace of God. And Ruth, at this moment, she's conscious of God's grace upon her life. Now, in verse 14, it says, and at mealtime, Boaz said to her, come here and eat some bread and dip your morsel in the wine. So she sat beside the reapers, and he passed to her roasted grain, and she ate until she was satisfied, and she had some left over. I'm actually trying to learn how to do what Ruth just did right there. Eat until I'm satisfied, and then just stop. It's very hard for me. There are no leftovers on a Nate Holdridge plate. But that's what Ruth did, and Boaz is being so obvious at this point, don't you think? I mean, there he is, like at the end of the day, he's like, man, I know I told her she could like glean here, and I know I gave her like the water jar offer, and I know I told her like to hang out with the young women, but what else could I do? And so he's like, hey, come over here to the meal. And at the meal, he's telling her like, hey, you can dip your bread in the wine, it's okay. And he's like handing her grain, you know, and like I'm sure everybody at the table is like, you're so obvious right now, you know, and he's just laying it all out there, just totally favoring her. And when she rose again, verse 15, to glean, Boaz instructed his young men saying, let her glean even among the sheaves and do not reproach her. You know, so the stuff we've already gathered, let her go to that. And also, verse 16, pull out some from the bundles for her and leave it for her to glean and do not rebuke her. So like, he's telling his workers, like, notice where she's walking and then like go get in front of her and just like dump some grain down there in front of her. And as she's cruising along, she's like, oh, you know, like, it's like when your little two-year-old's like doing an Easter egg hunt or something, you know, and they just can't find anything and you're just like bumping the eggs in front of them or whatever. That's what Boaz is doing for Ruth. It's this beautiful little thing. And so, verse 17, she gleaned in the field until evening. Then, verse 17, she beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. You guys are all cool on what an ephah is, right? All the time. All of an ephah of gasoline, please. No, an ephah is about 22 liters. So she has brought in a huge haul. Nobody goes out to glean and comes away with an ephah of barley. And so she beats it out and she goes home. And she took it up, verse 18, and went into the city. Her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. She also brought out and gave her what food she had left over after being satisfied. So her leftover dinner. And her mother-in-law said to her, where did you glean today? And where have you worked? Blessed be the man who took notice of you. So Naomi, she sees all this barley and she's like, look, something happened here. This is not, you know, normal. And so where did you glean? Where did you work? Look, we're going to close out and read these last few verses. But the final thing I wanted to tell you about Ruth, and I told you that she loved God and she loved Naomi. But what I want to tell you here is that she, in that attitude of knowing that God had given her grace, she also was a hard-working person. The worker at the beginning of the day told Boaz when he arrived that Ruth had already been there and that she wasn't even taking any breaks. And all day long she works and she gathers and she's carrying all this barley and she beats it out and brings it home. She's a hard-working person. God's grace had done this in her life. And I think the eyes of the Lord are looking for people like this that will work and labor. Paul, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he said something that I would almost think that you're not allowed to say it, but the Holy Spirit inspired him to say it. He said this in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 10, in talking about all the other apostles, he said, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And God's grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of the other apostles, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. I've always wondered about that little line. Like, what did the other apostles think when they read 1 Corinthians? And there's Paul, you know, talking about them and Christ's appearances, and he says, you know, the grace of God got a hold of my life. And God's grace made me into someone who worked harder than all of them. I bet they probably read it, and maybe there was a little part of their heart at first that said, oh man, you can't say that. But then probably very quickly, the Holy Spirit reminded them, no, it's true. You see the scars on that man's body. You see the continents that have been shaped as a result of his willingness to go and go and go and go. The grace of God made him into a man who worked so hard for the King, worked so hard for the gospel. And grace will do this in your life. Ruth was a woman who labored hard out there in that field. So, verse 19, after Naomi asked the question, where did you work? Whose field were you in? She told her mother-in-law with whom she had worked and said, the man's name with whom I work today is Boaz. And Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, may he be blessed by the Lord, whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead. Naomi also said to her, the man is a close relative of ours, one of our redeemers. So Naomi is celebrating because Boaz, it looks like, has taken an interest in their family, and he qualifies as a redeemer, as we'll see next week. And Ruth, the Moabite, verse 21, said, besides, he said to me, you shall keep close by my young men until they have finished all my harvest. And Naomi said to Ruth, verse 22, her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter, that you go out with his young women, lest in another field you be assaulted. So she kept close to the young women of Boaz, gleaning until the end of the barley and wheat harvests, and she lived with her mother-in-law. The way this scene ends is supposed to make all of us say, what? Because there they are out in this field. We know that they are going to get married. We see Boaz taking some of those first steps of initiation. And every day, she's going out to his barley field, going out to his wheat field, hanging out with the young women. Every day, he's taking care of her, and day after day goes by, and it's like you're waiting. You're waiting for Boaz to just bust a move already, and then the harvest ends, and Ruth goes home. And you're sitting there going, I thought they were going to get together. When are they going to get together? And that's what leads us to the events of chapter 3. But Ruth was a woman who, like James, would say, you have faith without works, I will show you faith with works. She had a marvelous faith, and the grace of God was poured out upon her life. So God, we pray and we ask today that you would do some of these types of things in our lives, Lord. We need you to give us, Lord, your kindness, your grace. We pray that your eye would find, Lord, what it needs to find in us. Lord, that your eye would see a heart that is blameless toward you, loving God and loving men. Lord, that you might involve yourselves in the details of our lives, that you might provide for us, Lord, in a way that no one else can. And so, Lord, we look to you. You're our help. You're our strength. We pray, Lord, that your grace would be upon us as your people. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together, church, and sing this closing song to the Lord.
I can hardly think as you pray.
Let's celebrate that this morning. A good Father. Amen. God bless you guys. We'll see you again next week.